Hello, and welcome to the next video in the Health Behavior Theory video series. I'm Dr. Lori Wagner, and this video is going to focus on the transtheoretical or stages of change model. The transtheoretical model was developed by Prochaska and DiClemente. It's a really helpful model when trying to gauge where a person is in their process of making behavioral changes. Every individual goes through these different stages when changing their behaviors. Generally, the stages are gone through in order. That's not to say that there isn't some backslide, nor that an individual spends the same amount of time as every other person might spend in that stage, or even the same amount of time in each stage themselves. Let's take a look at the constructs. So this is generally a directional model, where we look at a person's progression from one stage to the other. Our first stage is that of pre-contemplation. A person who's in the pre-contemplation stage is just going about their life. They're not thinking about a specific behavior. They are likely unaware or underaware of any problems their behaviors might be likely to lead to. And because of this, they are not planning on making any significant changes in the next 6 months. For these folks, we often direct advocacy campaigns or educational efforts to increase their awareness of their actual risks. Keep in mind our code of ethics and general best practices that guide us in not amplifying risks unnecessarily for individuals or populations, but rather for helping them understand what their actual calculated risks are due to their action or inaction. This is not a stage where we attempt to scare people into acting or behaving, but rather just increase their health literacy and their general understanding of how their behaviors might have consequences they'd like to avoid. The next stage is contemplation. In this stage, people might be thinking about all of their behaviors and identifying something specific that they might actually want to change. In the contemplation stage, people are aware of issues or problems related to their behavioral choices and are likely thinking about how they might take action to alter their behaviors within the next 6 months. Though they are examining how they currently do things and how they might be able to change the way they do those things, they're not yet entirely committed to making the change. This is important for us to understand because the person in contemplation might need our support in health positive ways. We are always attempting to increase a person's health literacy. In the contemplation phase, this might be encouraging them to think about their behaviors in ways that are more health positive. This might be a good spot to examine their thoughts and ideas using the health belief model to see in their thinking where their benefit and barrier balance is. Efforts and attempts to increase their perception of the benefits and decrease or eliminate the barriers are generally effective ways to propel people from contemplation into the next phase of this model. Preparation is an extremely important element of the model that's actually often overlooked. Think about New Year's resolutions. The average American might have been thinking about it prior to New Year's Eve, but generally sets those New Year's resolutions on New Year's Eve, which can be a little problematic because it's not uncommon that New Year's Eve involves staying up late, perhaps consuming adult beverages. Both of these things are likely to interfere with decision-making processes. And in addition, if someone just decides to do something without having a plan, the likelihood that they're going to be successful in that change is not very high. The average American actually breaks their New Year's Eve resolution just a couple weeks into the month of January. That decision on New Year's Eve at 11:30 p.m. to stop smoking or give up sugar or start working out more lacks the appropriate amount of preparation to be successful. And unfortunately, individuals instead of identifying that their planning was improper, they generally focus on the idea that they've failed at their resolution and so give up their attempt to alter their behavior. So let's look at preparation through a positive lens. The preparation stage is designed to encourage people to make a plan for their action, to specifically think about all of the elements that might help support their active behavior change. Really thoroughly examining what they're going to do, when they're going to do it, how they're going to do it, where they're going to do it, who they might do it with, why they're doing it, are all really vital elements of this phase. In this preparation stage, the person generally has an intention to make the changes within the next 30 days. They've also likely taken some action towards this overall change already. So let's say they're looking to quit smoking. They may have already investigated smoking cessation programs, but not signed up just yet. They may have thought about nicotine replacement products, perhaps even researched different versions, maybe communicated with a physician about which is most likely to be effective. All of these are important elements of preparation. What we're attempting to do in this stage is help the person identify that if they properly prepare, they are likely to be much more capable than when lacking preparation. The average American attempts to quit smoking 10 times before they are successful. And ultimately, the most successful way to quit tobacco is cold turkey. Generally, that's because the person is so fed up with the behavior that when they quit, they are actually finally done. But quitting cold turkey without any preparation is not that likely to be successful. Part of the preparation plan is including a plan for relapse. And though a person might wonder why you plan to fail in an action plan, it's actually a very important element of the process. Think about a prenuptial agreement as a way to actually help a marriage end in a more friendly way than when one or both parties are totally fed up, perhaps really angry or disappointed in each other, and maybe not thinking of the best outcome for all parties involved. Though most people don't want to go into a marriage planning for its ending, marriages that consider how they might dismantle themselves find that these actions when they get there are a lot easier when they've planned for it. This is similar but different when we're talking about health behavior changes. Let's go back to smoking. If a person has decided to quit smoking on a certain day and they've made all the plans to do so appropriately and they initiate the change, they stop smoking, it's not surprising that at some point in time in the future, they're going to want to smoke again. The desire to smoke might actually lead them to lighting a cigarette. Now that they've smoked that cigarette, what do? I like to think about it from the other side. If for some reason today I smoked a cigarette, I wouldn't instantly think of myself as a smoker and rush to go out and get all of the accoutrements that go along with smoking. Ashtrays, matches, more cigarettes. I'm much more likely to say to myself, "That was an interesting choice, Lori. Now let's brush our teeth and move on with our day." The person who's attempting to quit smoking needs to have the same attitude. Health coaches encourage folks who are trying to quit smoking to identify right away with being non-smokers rather than a person who is trying to quit smoking. That way, when they have that cigarette they were hoping to avoid, instead of feeling like they've failed at quitting smoking, which is super common, now that the individual has, quote, failed at quitting smoking, end quote, they identify as a smoker who wasn't able to quit. What we want to encourage them to do is identify as a non-smoker from the beginning. This way, should they slip up and have a cigarette, instead of identifying as someone who has failed at quitting, they can simply put out the cigarette and continue on their way as a non-smoker. Now, I don't mean to oversimplify this plan for relapse. There's a lot that goes into this, especially with the smoker. But the idea of planning for relapse is the important element here. In our plan of relapse, it's really important to be thinking about where the individual is on the spectrum of self-determination. The more a person has internal or intrinsic motivation, that is, the more likely they feel the actions are things they want to really be doing, the more likely they are to be successful. People who have external or extrinsic motivation, those who might be attempting to make the change because they are required to or feel like they should but don't really want to, are much more likely to fail in the action. This is why it's supremely important to focus on the individual's process in preparation. While it might seem easier to just tell the person what they need to do, it's much more effective to help the person identify their own reasons for the action. And again, tipping about helping them identify the benefits in a way that overcome or overpower the barriers. Always thinking about the benefits versus the barriers. Now, the action phase is where the behavioral change actually happens. This is where the person starts taking the actions that are the change. This is where the people are now not smoking, are eating healthier, are doing the exercise they planned for and prepared for. The action phase is still tenuous in that the person is still actively choosing to do or not do the behavior. It is still a conscious choice requiring effort. In the last phase of this model is when the person is just doing the behavior. They're living the change. Once a person has done something for at least 6 months is when we say they are in the maintenance phase. They're managing any relapses and working towards the termination phase, which is when the behavioral choice is now just a part of who they are in their daily living. Termination is one of those stages you'll often find represented in other people's depictions of the transtheoretical model. Just living their lives, right? You'll notice the additional construct I've added to our model is that of cue to action. I think this is important for health educators and health coaches in terms of having a readiness response for an individual when they experience that cue to action. We also use health education and health promotion to encourage that movement to contemplation. So that would be the cue to action. In health coaching situations, often something comes up in a session that is a cue to action, which helps propel the client into contemplation. This cue to action could be moved around this model. A client could already be contemplating, and the cue to action could send them into preparation. A cue to action could also move someone from preparation to action. The overall goal of this model is just to get the person out of it and just living their lives. So when is the best time to use the transtheoretical model? Anytime folks might be in different stages. So the people who have never thought about quitting smoking, as opposed to the folks that have attempted to quit smoking several times, for example, we would want to identify those folks so we could work with them in different groups. We also want to identify at what place they are in their readiness to change, so we know what kinds of support and facilitation we can offer them. This is especially true when progressive changes are required. Here is where we operationalize all the best practices and theoretically based change theories. I think that's an important side note too, is that the transtheoretical model identifies where people are, but generally requires other constructs and theories to help inform our work in moving the person through the stages. This would be true when we're attempting to maximize the effects of programming. We would plan a program for folks in contemplation very differently from folks who were in action, for example. Ultimately, the transtheoretical model helps us reduce those differences within our programming groups such that our interventions and educational programs are likely to be more effective. I hope this helps you feel like you have a better understanding of this transtheoretical model or stages of change. Be sure to check out my other videos to be better informed and better able to apply your health behavior theory in your work.